Mendez, for tonight's speaker, but it's more than just a speaking. You know, Scott's an anointed minister of God, and I've known Scott for, oh my gosh, we're trying to figure it out, maybe 10 or 15 years. I first met him when I worked at TVN, and he had appeared on TVN two or three times. I know with Kenneth Copeland, had you on, and I believe some other times that different TVN hosts interviewed you. He was a world champion bull rider. And I remember when I was just so fascinated with Scott with the bull riding, it's like, wait a second, I've seen that. When they fall off, the bulls are just jumping up and down and kicking all around you. What do you do? And he just said, you know, it's God. And, you know, he said, he gets in this zone and you know, he sees the hoofs all around, and it just, God protects him through all that.
That's right.
So this is the man we're going to be listening to tonight. But now he's going to tell you some things how you can be protected from, I guess you would call, the bulls of life, you know.
the
kicking, bronking bulls of life. But just let me give him a little bit more of a formal introduction here. Scott, I mentioned he's a world champion bull rider, but hey, he's an actor, a producer, and stuntman. He lives right here in Texas. He's a national sought-after speaker, prominent professional athlete, and spokesperson in bull riding and rodeo profession. His success in rodeo has opened many doors for him to be able to witness for Christ and speak on television and appear in movies. He's ministered extensively throughout the nation, especially cowboys and westerns and all. He's appeared in several films, and I didn't know this. City Slickers, I remember seeing that film.
Yeah.
That was a popular film. American Outlaws, Nail 32. His most recent production is a documentary called The Donna Reed Story, right? And that's coming out before the end of this year, and he's made several television appearances on different networks. I mentioned TVN and others. He uses his platform, this is what I appreciate, to motivate and help young people make the right choices in life. So Scott successfully mentors young men and women throughout through attraction to extreme sports and presents to them life lessons learned participating in rodeo. I was telling us about your 20-year-old son that's kind of going into some of that and may do some of those things. So and he'll be sharing his salvation experience and how he moved from conquering the beast in the world of bull riding, and now the Lord is using them to conquer the beast spiritually.
Amen.
So with that, let's welcome Scott Mendez.
Thank you, Lord. Bless you.
Praise God. Well, that was quite an introductory. Thank you.
Thank you, Douglas, for writing it.
God is good. What a blessing it is to be here. The Full Gospel Businessmen Association, I was visiting just a moment ago with Douglas, and thank you, Douglas Vernier, for having me, Doris Oboli, for this opportunity to share. I love Full Gospel Businessmen because in my ministry and in my life, I've seen very much a lot of fruit from the ministry. I've seen oil men, actors, prominent people, ordinary people, so into the work of Full Gospel Businessmen, and just be really blessed by the mission of it. And so it's an honor to be here with you tonight and to share. If it's okay, I'd like to pray, and then I'm going to share my testimony. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you tonight as we come together with food and fellowship and a wonderful organization, the Full Gospel Businessmen. Lord, I pray that this time of sharing my testimony, Father, would honor you and that you would be exalted, and Lord, that you would just use that message to bless your people. And we're thankful for all that you're doing in this world, and we ask, Lord, for a protection and a discernment to walk with you and allow the Holy Spirit to direct our lives, Father, that we can be strong and bold in our faith and serve you with all of our heart. That is our desire tonight. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise God. Well, I've been given the opportunity to have 20, 25 minutes to share with you guys. I like to kind of break it up, because as you know, when you're sharing a testimony, there's areas that you can get off on a side street, and I don't want to do that this evening at all. But I want to tell you that, you know, you really can't have a testimony without a test, amen?
Mm-hmm.
And in my childhood here in the Fort Worth area was exactly that. I believe that if the enemy can steal a child's dreams, aspirations, life at an early age, that's his motive. That's what he wants to do. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Right.
And for me, I was a byproduct of a praying grandmother. The Bible says, train a child in the way that he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from that.
That's right.
But I am so grateful that my grandmother prayed for me.
Amen.
And there was times in my life as a young person, I would go to her and I would ask questions. And she was always there for us. So I was born in 1969 in Visalia, California. And the thing for my childhood was that I had a mother and I had a father, but they lived 1,800 miles apart.
Wow.
My dad and his family and the rodeo legacy was on the West Coast. When I was in Fort Worth with my mother here in Texas, my grandmother, her father was a founder to downtown Fort Worth. He was an inventor, very successful. My grandmother married my grandfather, who had a legacy in ministry, which later in life would lay hands on me and my wife before we started our ministry. And really, through impartation, give us guidance and direction in the ministry that we were about to embark on. So as a small child, it was challenging because, like anybody, when you say, what was my life like before Jesus? As a child, I always sensed God's hand on my life because of a praying grandmother. And so one of my fondest, earliest moments of memory was flying from DFW to San Francisco, California, where my father was supposed to pick me up, and I looked out across the wing of the plane, and I just remember hearing the Lord say, I will be the father to the fatherless. Mm-hmm. And that's really the story of my childhood. It wasn't the fact that I didn't have a father, it's just my father wasn't engaged spiritually. He's a hard-working cowboy, and I'm thankful that he taught me those things in my life, because without one or the other, I would be incomplete.
Right.
And through the teaching and through allowing the Holy Spirit to guide my life, great things have happened, but obviously there was challenges and struggles that you would go through. So as a young person, I rode my first calf at 5 years old at a branding fire in California. My dad and his buddies thought it would be funny to put me on a calf to see how far I could ride. Little did they know God had a plan for that. I didn't even know at that time that God wanted to use me that way. But he does. He wants to use all of our lives.
Amen.
So I rode my first calf and rode 4 or 5 feet and fell off. And I had fun with it, but I want to just say this because of time. Like anybody, and I wrote these words. It says, like all of mankind, I was living under a curse and in bondage to sin, so that it was ruining my life. No matter how hard I tried to better understand and to be a better person, nothing I did ever would free my soul. We know that when you become a person of accountability, that you're responsible for different things. So I knew that God had a plan for my life, but coming from a divorced family like that was very shaking, and I had to do a lot of soul searching. I didn't really know who I was. We went through devastating things. I had two brothers. I had an older brother here in Texas. We had the same mom and a different dad. My brother in Nevada, we had the same father but different mother. So I was really actually an only child. But one thing I noticed was when my father was remarried one time, my stepmother, that was kind of a threat. And so I experienced what I would say is a spirit of rejection in that childhood, because I was safe and my dad could provide for me. He was teaching me life skills and life lessons. When I was with my mother in Fort Worth, she was a pastor's daughter. My mom had a lot of problems in her life. And so we would hear about faith, but we would come home to no food in the refrigerator, holes in our shoes. We would wonder if when we got home, if a truant officer would be there, child protective services would be at my front door. So I don't talk about my childhood a lot, but it was challenging to say the least. So to know that God had a plan for your life on the inside, but on the outside you're hurting and you're scared and you're insecure with your life, the only thing that I could do was to try to prove myself in this game called rodeo. It was a golden opportunity because rodeo is unlike any other sport. It's not franchised. You are your own doctor, physician, travel agent, all of those things. And so my dad would move from California. I won my first little junior rodeo in 1979. My dad in my junior high and high school years would move to Reno, Nevada. In Reno, Nevada, I was a teenager. And I had this ambition that in order for me to be successful in life, I had to earn the and prove myself in sports. And I just want to say the scripture right now. What is it that a man would gain the whole world and lose his own soul in the process? And what would a man give in exchange for his soul? And so that's the thing that's dangerous about rodeo. I started hanging out eventually later down the road with my heroes, and they weren't doing godly things. But I am grateful that rodeo gave me structure in my life that I needed. And at first it was challenging because you wanted to be like your heroes. But later in life, that would cost me a lot of things that I had to get straightened out as well. So when you say, what is your life like before Jesus? I was like anybody. Just like Deuteronomy 28 would say this, I put before you life and death. And he says that he wants us to choose life. But there's a lot of living and experience that one has to go through. So I was expressing myself through rodeo, and I went back and forth between Texas and California and Nevada. And I was searching and I was looking for my identity. How many know in here that our true identity is in a covenant relationship with Jesus Christ? And that sometimes we do put our identity in what we do, whether that's business, whether that's sports, or the lust of the flesh thereof. It does not matter. And when we do that, we are not getting any closer to being the one that God created us to be. And so that's Deuteronomy 8:18. I do want to read, I know I have the opportunity to read just a couple of scriptures. Listen to this. And this is what my life was like before Christ. He says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, for the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you were led by the Spirit of God, you are not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, and heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, rivalries, and of the like of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in time past, that those who practice these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. God's word was so cut and clear, and it was always in my lap. I would later try to defend myself by having a knowledge of God's word, but yet I did not have a relationship with him. The Bible says it this way, and I don't mean to preach, but I want to share it this way. He says that a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways, and he should not expect that he would receive anything from Christ Jesus. And in studying for this, I wanted to say this too. Deuteronomy 28 also says, under the curse, and he said, the Lord himself will send a curse on you of confusion and of frustration in everything you do until at least you are completely destroyed by doing evil and abandoning for me. For if you refuse to listen to the Lord your God and obey the commandments and the decrees that I have given you, all these curses will pursue you and overtake you, and then you shall be destroyed. Mm-hmm. So my life before Christ was known about Jesus Christ in my head, wanting to do things for him to gain his acceptance. Not only did I want my Father's approval, I wanted my Heavenly Father's approval. But through the testing of my youth and my adolescent years and trying to discover that when my grandmother said, Scott, you will do great things if you put Jesus Christ first in your life.
Amen.
I had to learn, what does that mean in life? How do I put Jesus Christ first when I'm with a father? We're at the sale barn, at the horse pen, and the cattle ranch, and everybody's cutting and cussing and spitting and all this fornication and idolatry going on all around me. How can I do that? And so I believe that God has always had his hand on my life. And it would take me a while to learn how to cooperate. It is a process. Salvation is a free gift. Sanctification takes a lifetime and a journey. So I want to encourage us in here tonight. My high school years, I was successful. I became a state champion twice. I went to the National High School Rodeo Finals, which was traveling to faraway states. So bull riding was starting to be a kind of a serious thing for me. When I was in Texas, I wanted to be a Dallas Cowboy because I grew up on these streets in Fort Worth over in the Meadowbrook area. And my oldest brother, my first concussion came from playing street football, not rodeo. They would pick me up and slam me on the ground, but I could run fast and catch, so that helped. And so again, two different worlds. How does one put those worlds together? You cannot do it without the help of Jesus Christ, having a relationship with him. My senior year of high school, I graduated. I wanted so bad to do well and to win the high school world finals, which would have been the national finals. The summer of 1998 was a challenging year for me. I had so much stress, so much confusion, so much warfare in my own heart and mind that I went through a physical and nervous mental breakdown at the high school national finals. It happened right when I was competing. Wow. To this day, I don't know that what I went through wasn't drugs. We smoked, we drank, we partied. Never did anything hard, but the effects of what I was going through would have said, this gentleman has been given something. Something has happened to him. And what I mean by that, I was at the rodeo and I had hallucinations. I thought the rapture had came. I was scared. And you got to remember, at 18 years old, my dad was not there. My mom was not there. I was really basically on my own from the time that I was 15 or 16 years old. My father worked me incredibly hard in the businesses. And so I never had that chance of being a child. And then I get out there competing. The older guys are around. They're doing stuff. So you do try to fit in a little bit at first, but after a while, when you realize this stuff is getting serious, you try to separate yourself from that. And you can't separate yourself from that unless you have character.
Amen.
And God would eventually, later on in my professional career, show me what character was all about.
Amen.
And how important that is. And so this confusion, this summer of 1987, where I had a nervous breakdown, I took about a year from rodeo, began to get myself better and to work through some of these issues. I know without a doubt that the enemy was very clearly spiritually trying to take me out. In my own heart, my own mind, my own life, I was able to overcome that. I spent some time in hospital. They wanted to give me medicine for this, medicine for that. They basically were trying to say, look, your mom has a lot of problems, so you must have problems. And at that time, I probably did. But I'm glad that God showed me that, because he made it very clearly that I better slow down, I better pay attention, even at 18 years old. I was probably physically as mature as any man, but emotionally I had been damaged. And that's the thing about the ministry today, is working with young people to help them to understand that your soul, your mind, your will, your emotion, you can be saved, but are you walking spiritually with God? And so there's a lot of things in between there. So after that season of time, the nervous breakdown, when I graduated high school, I began to allow God more place in my life. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. So I started getting stronger. I wanted to make the national finals rodeo. I didn't go to college. I went one day to practice with them, and there wasn't anything in there that I couldn't handle, and I told the coach I need to go to Las Vegas, which is the Super Bowl of rodeo, so I wanted to get there very, very quickly. 91, I made the national finals rodeo. 92, I made the national finals rodeo again. So I was kind of positioning myself as a professional athlete that needed help. But again, I had a head knowledge of Jesus Christ. I didn't have a covenant with him, or I hadn't sold out to him and given him my heart. All things would change. And I want to talk to you guys a little bit now about how did I come to know Jesus Christ. After all that was behind me of being insecure, growing up, knowing that God has a plan for your life, not walking with him, and being exposed to a wide open world of rodeo. And rodeo, again, is something that can raise you for the positive or for the negative, if you could say it that way. And I understood later on in life what it meant to have the work of the flesh and to know that I needed to be doing other things to help me. How many know in 1 Corinthians it says that the Bible is foolishness to a man that has never given his heart to Christ Jesus? And so I was very much at, wanting to do things for God. But quickly, for time, in 1994, I was at the national finals for my third time. And I was in a position to win on the last day. We had a 10-day competition. This particular day, I was in a place where I could win and become a world champion. I dreamed my whole life of becoming a world champion, to have the acceptance of my father, my earthly father, my heavenly father, and I wanted to do things for God. But I was not living for him. And this is how cool God is. He allowed me to get within seconds of being able to have that in 1994. So I'm getting ready to tie my glove on. My friend's bull comes out and it's down to the last four riders, and I'm one of them. My friend's bull came out and went right in front of my buck and shoot. He rode about 6.5 seconds. He he got bucked off. As he was coming off the bull, his leg and foot got caught in his rope, which allowed his body not to land next to the bull, but very close to underneath him. And so when the rope slid his body over, the bull jumped 4 or 5 foot in the air and came down, and he stepped on my friend's head. And I was tying my glove on, thinking that today is the day that I'm going to do all these great things for Jesus Christ. How many know that God didn't want me to have that world championship until he had that world championship through and into my heart? That day, if I would have won, I would have never, ever had the things that I have today. Marriage, 23 years, 3 beautiful kids, 2 are here tonight. I've been a blessed man. Amen. Whenever I gave my heart to God. Amen. Go ahead. So my friend gets stepped on. And when I was sitting on my grandmother's foot of her bed one time, I asked my grandmother, I said, "Grandmother, what happens to our life when our life is done here?" She said, "That's very easy, Scott. You're going to go before the judgment seat of Christ. He will evaluate your life and examine it, whether or not you were faithful to use the gifts and the talents to serve him to the fullest capacity you could with what he gave you." When I watched my friend get stepped on, I instantly, and this is a young man running recklessly, going over that season of my graduating high school, trying to do things for God. When I saw my friend stepped on, not in an audible voice, but just in a knowing voice, a revelation in my head said, "Scott, if that's you, you would have missed your eternal dwelling place." You want to talk about shake a cowboy up in his boots? That shook me up, because I was pretty fearless, and it wasn't that I was concerned about dying if I got stepped on. You don't enter bull riding with that kind of mentality. If it happens, it happens. They all say you go out doing what you love. I was not afraid of that, but I was afraid of missing my eternal destination with Christ Jesus. And I can remember seeing my grandmother praying for me in the spirit, growing up as a child, and telling me I would do great things. And she would feed us, you know, on Sunday afternoons and watch a football game. She was the stability that we needed, or we would have been even lost. My mother would leave me with pastors and not come back. One of the pastors she left me with for the last 25 years has been on my board of directors. He wanted to adopt me and my older brother. And they also have an orphanage in Indian Africa. And so, loving people. So my impersonations was, pastors are good guys. They'll take you in, they'll feed you, and they'll teach you the word of God. So I'm grateful that my mom, in the midst of all those challenges, I didn't say it before, several stepfathers. I didn't know. They tried to change my name so many times, baptized me in and out of different churches. It was a fiasco, to say the least. But through that all, God could have had his hand on my life the way he had on Samuel. I had no idea that God would do the things that he would do in my life that he's doing today. But it came down to that decision of dying to self, dying to Scott's ways, dying to God, to Scott's interpretation of how to work for Jesus and how to gain these worldly things. So I saw my friend lay there lifeless, and I heard these words, "Depart from me, for I never knew you." And that scared me, folks. I walked out of that building. I had not met my wife yet, so I was still a single man at the highest level of Super Bowl, 3 years running, trying to find my identity. And I walked out of that building, and I said, "God, I don't know how you can use an old bull rider like me, but if you can, I will serve you all the days of my life." And I want to tell everybody in this room today that God is faithful. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and we don't care if we live in the 21st century and we try to paint him with all kinds of entertainment and the things that we do today. We must go back to the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We must evangelize, we must have revival, and we must stand strong in the faith.
That's right.
And so I was standing strong in the faith, but I want to share this. In 1994, that day I bucked off my bull, I would become a runner-up. How many know that? That first place, I was a first place loser. I was runner-up to a world championship, and I didn't like that too well either. Even though God had straightened me out, I said, "God, we got to go back someday and get this straight and finish it." And that would happen 3 years later. In 1997, I would win the world championship. In 1995, 1996, I want to share this with you. There was an organization that formed. All of my heroes came together. And it was a professional bull rider league. I won't call any call letters just because it doesn't matter. I was one of the original founders to this organization. The problem with my life and that organization, and I tell people I can use this name, I was kind of like Tim Tebow of rodeo. I took a stand for God, but the question was, can this cowboy stand under the pressure of financial sacrifice? Can this man preach what he, live what he preaches? Can this man stay married to his wife? Can this man love his children? Can all these things started, you know, to come? Is when you put yourself out there and say, I am a Christian, what does that mean? That means a lot. And in professional sports, it's real easy to say, oh, yes, Lord, I love you when the cameras are on. And then when you turn around in the locker room, it's the good old boy thing. And I couldn't do that. God changed my heart so much that day. And I realized that my life that I now live is the life that I live in Christ Jesus, because Jesus died for me, and he has invaded my heart, and he has made it possible for me to live the rest of these lives. And I'm going to take full advantage. If I was a radical in the world without Christ, I'm going to be a radical for Jesus Christ. Amen? So I hear this man, he's given a prophecy. I know that some of you in this room may have heard of Smith Wigglesworth, the great apostle of faith. I was only saved for about 3 weeks, and let me back up and tell that real quick. At my friend's funeral, I traveled from Las Vegas. I've never talked to anybody, more than three people in a room, ever. I had dyslexia. I couldn't read. I was a quiet, insecure person. Well, my friend dies, and I'm on the plane, and they ask, will you speak when we get to Austin? We go to Austin. And I wrote a little eulogy up, and I stood in front of 3,000 or 4,000 people, and I read that. And from that day forward, when I realized that it's not about my insecurities, it's about what Christ Jesus has called me to be in my life, what he created me and what he anointed me to do, that I would do that with all of my heart, no matter what. And so from that time, I stood up, and I've never sat down. I've never, ever backed down from the opportunity to share, just like tonight. That weekend, I met my wife, Angel, and we fell in love. She will tell you that I led her to the Lord through the Jesus Film Project. I led her to the Lord, but I also needed to rededicate my life. I had just enough of the Word to know that if we were going to live for God, we need to do it right. So we were together for a season. We actually separated, and in our travels, what would happen is I saw a man on television preaching. His name is Pastor Casey Treat from Seattle, Washington, Tacoma area. And I fell in love with what he was ministering on. And I'll just tell you straight up, he was ministering on Romans 12:2. And it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may test and prove what is that acceptable and pleasing will of God. And I was asking God, if you're going to use me, you're going to have to show me what we're working with. And I was insecure. We're not working with much here without you. Apart from me, you can do nothing. But with me, you can do all things. Amen. So I stepped into that. And Angel and I, after I led her to the Lord, we were traveling. I got to share this. We're traveling to Denver from Phoenix. And I popped the movie, the Jesus movie from Bill Bright's Campus Crusade. And I just drove, and I looked over at her. And she had came from a religious background. But loved her, and I was explaining what Jesus was. At the end of that film, she was weeping. I pulled over. We prayed together, got back in, went to rodeo. We ended up in Seattle, and we attended a service at Casey Treat's service. And I turned out at rodeos to do that, and you don't turn out at rodeos unless you just can't walk. And we were way up in the Northwest, and we went. And so I began to start giving and sowing in to my relationship with Jesus. And he is so awesome to fill us up, to make us complete, to show us what he wants to do. And so Angel and I answered an altar call. Casey Treat physically laid hands on us. And we were filled with baptism of the Holy Spirit, the evidence of speaking in tongues, the gifts of the Spirit. We were children and just united in our faith and love for one another. And then again, it was her and I against the rodeo world at that time. It wasn't popular to be a Christian cowboy. And it wasn't 6 months or a year down the road that I was in these board meetings that these sponsors wanted me to have all these endorsements. They started making rules against me so that I wouldn't have money if I didn't give them the exposure as an athlete in the league on television. And they also required me to be out at the bar at 3 o'clock in the morning signing autographs. That's not a good thing for a man of God to be doing, right? So I gave up sacrificially millions of dollars in my relationship with Christ Jesus. Eventually my shares would sell for millions of dollars in the last few years. But I do want to say this. God told my wife and I both. He said, come out from among them and be ye separate. He said, you can either follow man or you can follow me. And when we followed God, it didn't look like nothing. It was a dusty road. And so we started going out doing rodeo Bible camps and ministering to kids. And we would be there while all my friends were riding for millions of dollars and notoriety, endorsements, and all those things. And I'm just here to tell you that when this thing is all said and done and we're getting ready to go to our heavenly dwellings, what we do here, all the buckles, all the things that we have, are they really going to be worth anything? The Bible says the seen is temporal, but the unseen is eternal. Amen. And so God clearly showed me that I needed to take off the old man and I needed to put on the new man. He simply says, if you love me, you will obey my word. You see, I had a heart problem. And I needed to get the knowledge from my head down into my heart so that it could fully bring forth a harvest in my life. I was so mad when I found out that the only way the devil was beating me, because I was a fighter, was that he was beating me by my own heart. Mm-hmm. If he allows a negative thought to go into your mind, to drop down into your spirit, man, and you believe that you're a nobody, you believe that you can't do this because you don't have the resources to do it, then you won't do it. But God has called every one of us to be conformed into the image of his son. Amen. And he needs people in the marketplace, rodeo, to stand up for Christ Jesus. Amen. For all things, no matter what the cost is. Because if he's asked me to give something up, then he's got something better for me to go up. Amen. In that kingdom of God. And so I just want to encourage us in here that, and I have a lot of scriptures, a lot of things, my time is limited. But I want to tell you, when I sold out to God, it was one of those things that was called no compromise. You see, the Bible says, do not be deceived, for God is not mocked, for whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. If God would give me today what I was justly due for being a cowboy, running around crazily and aimlessly in the world and listening to lies and the negativity of the enemy and the world around me, I would never have anything that I have today. And I want to compel everybody in here to look at our lives and to examine our heart. Because here's the thing, folks. When we stand before that judgment seat of Christ, we cannot change our answers to where we want to spend eternity. Game done. When God says, what have you done with the gifts and the talents I gave you? It's not like he doesn't already know. Just like Adam and Eve, you know, where are you, Adam? He knew where they were. Sometimes he wants us to say it out of our own mouth so that we can believe it. Amen? And at that time, I think, is what we must do. The Bible says, store up your treasure in heaven where rust and moth and dust. And this whole thing about having prestigious recognition and name and notoriety and all that. And folks, I've seen that even in the church. But I want to tell you one thing, that God wants to know us on an individual basis. He wanted to know me in 1994 before I ever got crowned to be a world champion. He would make me wait 3 more years. What would happen? I would get married, something that you're not supposed to do as an athlete, as a cowboy. He would bring children in my life. He's blessed me above whatever I could imagine, ask, or think. Amen. And he is no respecter of a person. Amen. And it does begin. The Bible says that there's a form of godliness, but we deny its power. We cannot play religion. A pastor told me one time, a good friend of mine, he said, religion is when we worship God for what he has done in the past, but we resist him for what he's trying to do in the present. You see, this Bible, this word of God, and it sits on the coffee table, and it collects dust. Or when I was trying to read it to defend myself against my friends, I wasn't putting my heart into it. He said, you worship me with your lip, but your heart is far from me. That was me. Every scripture I read was illuminated to say, that is me. And I am so grateful that God showed it to a simple-minded cowboy, because I'm not very educated. And it takes childlike faith to come to him. We have to break our free wills. And when we break our will, God invades our life. Amen. He transforms our heart, and it is total transformation. It's that whole renewing of your mind, which is every day of our life we should be growing spiritually and asking God to help us in our life. Amen. Do not love the world or anything in the world. Anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man and the lust of his eyes and the boasting of what he has and does, comes from the Father, but from the world, not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires are passing away, but the man who does the will of God shall abide forever.
Amen.
So I say all that tonight, folks, with my time allotted, that the choice is up to you and I. What will we choose? People choose what is convenient, what is emotional to answer an altar call in their life. But then do they go home and look in the mirror, the character of what, when nobody is looking, what will we do at that time? And God knows all things. And as we evangelize throughout this nation, we call it conquering the beast. That's a visual of riding the bull in the arena. But the battle that goes on in our life every day, are we fighting with lust or fear or pride? These are things that are raging against our soul to take up authority higher than the one that has first given you authority, and that's your Father in heaven.
That's right.
I did not want to walk out of those business meetings. I would have just as soon had all those endorsements and had money coming in. Yeah. It's easier to feed your family that way, but God said, hey, my ways are higher than their ways. My plans for you are better than those plans.
Yes.
And so I went on and I became a champion and I lived for Christ Jesus. And I know that everybody in this room can do that too.
Oh,
and I
yes.
want to compel and to challenge us today
Amen.
To understand, identify what's in our heart, examine it so that when we stand before God, we won't need to change that answer, that we'll
right.
be longing and worshiping. The Bible says that there is a gown of righteousness, and there's a robe of righteousness, and there is a gown of salvation. I don't want to just get into heaven by the skin of my
right.
teeth. I've got to operate in faith so that when I get there, I can get the inheritance.
Amen.
James said, I am drawn away by the lust of my own flesh, my own desires. And if my desire to be a sports figure and a champion was greater than a desire to be a man of God, I could have those things and the end of it would be death.
Yes.
For who sows to the flesh will reap corruption
That's
and
right.
die. But he who sows to the Spirit will have everlasting life.
Amen.
He says, for the wages of sin are death. But the
yes.
gift of God is
yes.
eternal life.
Oh, yes.
The choice is ours, folks. I don't have much more time, but I am grateful to share my story and the things that we're doing in media today. But I want to encourage you to understand that sometimes just, you know, playing church or answering an altar call isn't what being a Christian is all about. And allowing the Holy Spirit to move in our life, we must give him place to do so.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is a gentleman. He's not going to force his way on you. He said, I will resist the proud, but I will give grace to the humble.
Amen.
And we need that grace. Not sloppy grace, not leftover grace. We need enduring grace.
Amen.
We need steadfastness. We need the fruit of the Spirit in our life. Love, joy, temperance, long-suffering. It's amazing how we can pull out the ones we like. And sometimes we don't preach the ones that hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here to tell you that there's going to come a day when God will show us open book everything. So let's get real with him today.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I love you guys. I want to ask Mr. Douglas to come back up and thank you guys. It's my Father.
Wow, what an incredible message for each and every one of us here. And Scott, thank you so much. One of the things we need to do when we get ready to close on a full gospel meeting is that full gospel means that we work in all the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Not just one, but all. And you can find what those gifts are over 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 10. And in that, we can work with the gift of utterance. So if anyone here has never spoken in tongues, what it's all about,